Nahalem is a environmental coordinator, a NEPA nerd, fellow NEPA nerd, here on the Arapaho Roosevelt National Forest and Pawnee National Grasslands. We call it the ARP. And so I've invited Nahalem to talk about, first of all, what is it? What's the life of a NEPA coordinator like? Kind of what are some of the kind of day-to-day or week-by-week kind of tasks and issues that she has to deal with? And then talk through a couple of examples. I mentioned to Nahalem that we read through the Elkhorn Project EA. And so she can talk a little bit about that, but she's also working on a current interesting topic that she can share and sort of work through some of these other challenges. So without further ado, I hand it over to Nahalem. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, thanks, Tony. Thanks for having me, everybody. Do you mind if I close this door? Because
go ahead.
I think it has to do with when I worked in fire suppression, all the like chainsaw noise.
Okay.
So whenever there's background noise, it's terrible. So I'm Nahalem Clark. I work up the street here from the National Forest Service. And I currently am a planner, but I thought I would tell you a little bit about what I've done in the past. Just, I'm guessing some of you might work for the federal government down the road. And let's see here. I got an undergraduate degree in geography at Western Washington University in Bellingham, Washington. I grew up in Washington State, and I focused on resource management. And let's see here. And I knew definitely leaving my undergrad that I wanted to work doing something outdoors, land management related. So my first job was for the Inyo National Forest out in the Eastern Sierras, processing like permits for Mount Whitney, so an overnight permit system, GS4. And then I went to the National Park Service for a little while and did fire effects monitoring for them. Then I moved into wildfire suppression. So I worked at Sequoia Kings Canyon, then I worked for Rocky Mountain National Park, Alpine Hotshots, and then I worked for the Nature Conservancy out in South Carolina doing prescribed fire. Let's see here. After that, I went back to Rocky Mountain National Park and ran their noxious weed program. And then I decided somewhere about 5 or 6 years in that I was probably either going to be a seasonal employee or a furloughed term employee in the low GS range, and I should go back to school. So I went and got my graduate degree at CU down the road, and in ecology. Then I worked for APHIS, which is also a Department of Agriculture agency that does a lot with trade and agricultural pests, that kind of thing. So Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service. And then I, you get to give the presentation today.
Oh, yeah.
If you're late, yeah.
Your assistant.
So then I moved out to the Pawnee grassland and worked as a range management specialist. So did a lot of work with the grazing associations out there, the ranchers that are older than like your great grandparents, but really neat people. And then that brings me to my current position, which is a planner for Canyon Lakes Ranger District. So the reason I kind of bring you through my resume a little bit is it's been really fun working in a variety of disciplines. It also, I think, gives me some good perspective about some of the issues that we're working with, whether it's recreation related or fisheries related or whatnot. When you're planning a document, there's all these parts and pieces that you should consider when you plan a project. So I think it helps when you do NEPA, not critical. A lot of what I do right now is managing process. So it's okay, we've got this project, here's some of the things that we need to do. Today I'm gonna talk about three different NEPA projects I've worked on recently, because I wanted to give you a taste of from the fairly straightforward to the more complex. And it's not really always about the analysis. A lot of times, the NEPA is a step and a process we need to go through, but a lot of times when you're planning projects, you're working with stakeholders or partners or folks that are really mad at you and want you to do something. I mean, just all those things. So the level of public involvement or complexity related to the politics or your partners just can totally vary with each project. So Tony said that you all have talked a lot about NEPA theory and you've read all the CEQ regs, and you guys are, don't quiz me on anything because I haven't looked at those in a while. But you know what? The beauty of the internet is you just go and find something when you need it. So what else did I want to tell you? So what else about my daily life? So I do a lot with managing process. I'm a typically a team leader for our interdisciplinary team. So one thing I'm doing today is meeting with my interdisciplinary team for one of the projects that I'll talk about today. Another thing that I do in my regular life is facilitate for our leadership team. So that's like our forest management team. So I'll kind of plan their meetings and then help them through decision-making process. So, okay, you guys have 30 minutes. Here's where you need to get. What information do you need to get there? So that's kind of a fun side thing. And I'm also having a meeting related to facilitation today. So I'm trying to think what else I do. Those are like the really big primary things. I also sit on the district staff, so I'll fill in behind the district ranger when she's out of town or at meetings or whatnot. So I want you guys to introduce yourselves and then tell me a few things. Tell me what you're studying, what you think you want to do after school. So first your name, what you're studying, what you want to do after school. Not like today, but in general after school. And then if you've worked with NEPA at all. So I recognize you. You've worked for us, haven't you?
Gillenora for Robles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did Four Seasons.
That's right. Tell me your name.
Chad Avery.
Yeah.
Good
to see you again.
Resource stewardship. And after school, I'll be going back to the Carson Ranger District. And I'm both got it.
Okay, great. Good. So have you worked with NEPA?
I don't know.
Okay, cool. That's fine.
My name's Allie. I'm a Master of Botany student.
Okay.
And after I graduate, I've worked with the Forest Service for a few seasons, and I'd like to continue working for them. I'm not really sure what type of a position I would be looking for, but yeah, so we'll see.
Where have you worked?
I worked in Washington, Montana, and then I worked for the last four seasons down at Pagosa Springs, San Diego National.
Okay, cool.
Kyle O'Neill, Master of Natural Resource Stewardship. I've really worked with NEPA before. I've been involved in federal work for two seasons, I guess, in and out of college.
Okay.
I don't really know what I would like. I don't know what would be ideal. It'd be cool to work for federal agency again, or ecological restoration consulting firms.
Okay.
I'm Sarah Bowman. I'm getting my master's in natural resource sustainability as well, focusing on rangeland.
Okay.
And so after graduating, I would love to do some kind of range management, land management, preferably with BLM, who knows. I haven't really worked with NEPA yet, though.
Okay.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's great.
My name's Leah. I'm a toxicology student.
Okay.
After school, I think I'd like to work for an environmental consulting firm, or a different kind of consulting firm. I haven't worked with NEPA.
Okay.
I'm Paul. I'm also in the Natural Resources Stewardship Program. Don't really know what I want to do as a career, but I'm definitely kind of leaning towards federal agency.
I'm Tate. I'm in the MS Stewardship Program. And I've not worked with NEPA, and I haven't thought too much about what I'm going to do after graduating, but I'm thinking about resource management and forest services.
Okay.
I'm Lauren. I'm in my master's in forest science, and I want to go into environmental planning and environmental policy type work, so this is going to be really important.
Okay.
And I want to start in the public sector and then move to more private consulting once I have experience.
excuse me, I'm Sean, natural resource stewardship with a forestry specialization. And I'd like to possibly be a pre-sale forester. I've been working in the San Juan National Forest for 4 years now.
I'm Brian, Masters of Natural Resource Stewardship, also forestry. I've not worked with NEPA. I think after I graduate, I'd like to do at least one or two seasons with the Forest Service and then go into nonprofit with something like the TNC.
Okay, yeah, very good.
I'm James, MS in Forest Science, focusing on the ESA. I guess I've dabbled a little bit in NEPA with a nonprofit, but I'm just kind of dabbling. And after I graduated, I'd like to eventually go to law school or continue working for a nonprofit.
Okay. Good. Cool. That's great. You guys made me think of a couple things. So I'm mainly just going to talk about NEPA, but I'll just recruit you a little bit to the federal service. So I have almost 15 years in the federal government. I told you I've worked for a few different agencies. I haven't really worked in the private sector, nor in like environmental consulting, but we do work with groups that is like third party. They do NEPA for us. So do you ever bring folks that do consulting in? Because that'd be an interesting perspective.
Not in this class,
okay.
In other classes.
Yeah. That'd be an interesting perspective. But so you might be interested. So with the Forest Service, at least a third of our workforce is going to be eligible for retirement in the next 5 years. I mean, we keep hearing about baby boomers retiring, but it is seriously happening. And the great thing is there are a lot of opportunities right now. So it does feel like working for the government, you have to kind of get in at an entry level and work your way up. That's not always the case, but it works well, or it's a good way to kind of build up. But what I'm seeing is a lot of movement right now because people are retiring in higher graded positions and then folks are moving around. And we also need more young people in our agency. So I think it's a good time. I mean, you'll hear about budgets going up, budgets going down. We're sort of in a budget decline now. But like I said, with so many people retiring, I think it's a good time and there are good opportunities. So. Well, I'll just keep this pretty informal. Feel free to ask questions. I'm going to tell you about three projects I've worked on recently. One is related to similar to the Elkhorn project that you read. The name of that one was the Cherokee Park project. So that had a variety of sort of forest management type projects in it. I'll talk about CE or a categorical exclusion that I'm working on right now related to flood recovery. And then I'll talk about the big project I'm working on. It's going to be an EA, but it's related to sport shooting or target shooting on the National Forest. So that's a forest-wide project. I wanted to give you a flavor because the intensity of the project just really depends on what the issue is, what your level of public interest is, what your partners and stakeholders want, how complex does the analysis need to be, are there categories or CADEXs we can use to cover it. So I'll kind of just give you a flavor of what happens in the real world. Next year, Tony won't have me come next year, but if I were to come next year, I would be talking about three totally different projects. So, I hope so, at least. Okay, so like I said, I'll keep it informal, and you're welcome to interrupt and ask questions as we go. Okay, so let's see here. So I told you I'm going to talk about three projects, and for each one, we can kind of hit on these little check boxes here. What was the need for action? Why did we come up with the project in the first place? You got to have that before you just start doing NEPA. What's the scope of it, both geographically and also how does it relate to all the forest resources or not? What's the complexity? So that could be social complexity, that could be resource complexity, that could be design complexity. It could have to do with clear cuts and visual resources. So we'll talk about complexity a little bit. I'll talk to you about the involvement of the internal interdisciplinary team. I'll talk about The level of public involvement or public engagement, those are a couple of different things, a little bit. How much has the line officer participated? So remember, that person's going, in the Forest Service, they're called line officers, so that's the person responsible for signing the final decision. At my level, it's either the district ranger or the forest supervisor. And then I'll talk about partners and stakeholders. And you'll see that there's some real differences between these three projects, and then we can talk and discuss anything you want. Okay, so the first project is the Cherokee Park project. We finished that, it's been maybe like 12 to 18 months ago. So if we're here in Fort Collins, run up 287, and let's see here, Cherokee Park is sort of in this area. So it's really in the very northeastern part of the Canyon Lakes Ranger District. It's one of our, this is another map, zoomed in on the Cherokee Park area. It's one of our more low elevation pieces of the district. So as you move kind of towards Highway 287, it's more open ponderosa, really like lots of granite outcrops. As you move west towards the foothills and mountains, more lodgepole pine, a little bit of mixed conifer. So what you'll notice about this map and what made this project pretty interesting is you'll notice the checkerboard land ownership pattern that's a remnant from the whole railroad deal. That makes management very, very difficult because, it just depends on the situation, but there's a lot of private land in holdings in this area. There's a lot of locked gates. There's some state land board land in this crosshatch, which is not too big a deal, but it makes management complex in an otherwise kind of straightforward type of work that we do a lot. This map depicts some of the vegetation management type treatments that we plan to do in that area. So the different colors are just which ones would be mechanically treated with machinery, and then which ones would be treated with more like chainsaws and by hand and piled. So let me think about what else I can tell you about this project. So it's kind of bisected by 80C and 59, if you're familiar with that area. So Red Feather Lakes would be down to your south and west. Let's see here. What you might see on the map, but it's really hard to depict, well, so you'll see some major roads. There's also, like I said, there's a number of private land in holdings and a lot of roads to get to those places. Okay, so for this project, we plan to do three major types of work. And again, this is pretty routine stuff that we do a lot. So the vegetation treatments. So in the lower elevation ponderosa pine, we plan to do kind of some more fuels reduction type work. And then in the upper elevations, there was quite a bit of mountain pine beetle mortality, especially as you get right towards like Tai Siding in the Wyoming border. A lot of mortality, so we're planning to take out some of those larger dead patches. One of the challenges we sort of face with fuels reduction treatments in this area is not having really, really good access. And in our lower elevations, we don't get a lot of good winter snow cover, which allows us to burn piles. So that's one of the tricky things that we sort of had to talk through as an internal team about what could we do on the ground that would really be feasible. We also did some travel management as part of this NEPA. So we looked at the entire road system in the Cherokee Park Planning Unit. And we said, which of these roads do we need and we want to continue to pay to maintain? And which of these roads do we not need anymore? They're either duplicative or they just don't go anywhere. Maybe they were user created and we don't want a road right next to that stream, that kind of thing. And then we also looked at conifer encroachment into meadows and aspen stands and looked at where we might like to remove those young conifers to maintain the meadow or aspen stands. So depending on who you talk to about NEPA, they'll say you should stay focused. You should just do a single type of action. Like you should just focus on vegetation treatments or just on travel management. Don't muddy the water and put too much treatment complexity in your NEPA document. So that's a really nice way to go. It keeps it nice and clean. The reality is it costs a fair amount of money to engage all your specialists, go out to the field, look at sites, plan the project, and for efficiency's sake, I do think there's an advantage to doing, I wouldn't even call it quite big gulp, but looking at a whole area and saying, what needs to be done in here? And sometimes these things can be done in concert. So for example, if we identified a road through this travel management process that also coincided with one of the units where we were gonna do a some kind of harvest, we could use the machinery that was on site to decommission the road on the way out of that unit. And we do that a lot with our stewardship projects in particular. But so there is an efficiency of kind of combining things. It does make it more complex, and maybe the public thinks it's weird. But that's sort of, this is an example of where we did combine this. Tony mentioned that one of your groups is talking about focused EAs. So this project wasn't so focused in terms of the type of activities we were proposing, but the entire document's like 50 or 60 pages, and I'm kicking myself because I had it on my desk, and I wrote to here this morning, so I actually didn't run by and grab it. So compared to the Elkhorn EA that you all looked at, which is more like 150 or 60 pages, similar type of work, but what we did in the EA was try to take out the superfluous information and sort of condense it down to, here's what you really need to know. It's not taking out information as much as summarizing it. So I like that it's easier to read and that somebody might actually look it through the entire document. Yeah.
Can I ask?
Sure.
In that document from the Elkhorn to this one, what's an example of superfluous information that you would take out?
Oh, okay, sure, yeah. So the wildlife biologist always...
Sorry,
he was asking, like, between Elkhorn and this Cherokee Park project, NEPA or the EA, what's the superfluous information you take out? So the wildlife biologist always prepares a biological evaluation. So that will go into the life history of every wildlife species that they're concerned about in that area. And so it'll say, this is their breeding behavior, this is their habitat, this is how many we think there are. So all of that information for, I don't know, 45 species was included in Elkhorn. You'll notice, and I took some of that out, tried to summarize it. So that takes out about 30 pages probably by saying, if you're really interested in Preble's jumpy mouse or goshawk, that's in the specialist report. So the specialist report's still available that has all that detailed information, but I kind of liked that the Focus DA had, here's what you need to know, here's what's really relevant. Because you can add lots and lots of background information, but it needs to be relevant to what the decision maker needs to know before they make a decision. So some people like to add, you know, it's just a matter of preference, but some people like to add anything that they think might be related. So it's a little bit of style, but we are trying to go to more focused EAs. Okay, so Cherokee Park. So pretty straightforward. You know, we've been doing veg management type treatments on the district and the forest for quite a while, so the public's kind of used to it. Like I said, there's quite a few homes up there, so folks are pretty supportive of doing fuels reduction around their home. There's a lot of mountain pine beetle mortality. Let's see here. So there's generally support for doing that kind of work. Aspen and meadow enhancement. People are like, yeah, sure, we think aspen stands and meadows are good. Cool, that's great. Travel management. Seems straightforward, right, to look at what roads do we need, what roads do we not need. This was the very stickiest issue for this project because we have all of these subdivision type neighborhoods up in Cherokee Park. So if I go back to this slide, so there's folks living, you know, on these private land parcels, like multiple, maybe like 40 acre parcels, like all on this private land. So if you go up these main county roads, there's these gates. The public doesn't have great access to some of this public land because of that intermix that I talked about. So travel management on this particular project was a big deal because some of the subdivisions were very concerned that it would affect their ability to access their homes. And then they were also really worried about whether the result of this would mean that the public could actually get into some of these places through their driving through public and private property. So that was the stickiest part for that this project. I think we did just one public meeting and got maybe with a 30-day comment period. We maybe got I'm just gonna guess 20 comment letters, something like that, mainly from folks that live up there.
Do they have like a property association or kind of a more convenient way, efficient way to?
Yeah, so there are maybe like four or five homeowners associations up there, like subdivision.
And are they so subdivided and not just big contiguous?
Yeah. So, and then we did get a couple few objections on this process related to the travel management stuff. When I talked to the regional office, they're like, don't put travel management in your NEPA documents because it's like a big, big deal right now. People are really concerned about, access. Folks are concerned about access either being cut off, or there's other groups that are maybe more conservation related that are concerned about the impacts of roads. So it's actually turned out to be a pretty contentious issue. And you'll know that we have like millions of miles. The Forest Service has millions of miles of road. We can't afford to maintain them all, and when they're not well maintained, you know, we lack the engineering and ability to control erosion, and then they turn into really, really horrible roads. So, let's see here. Oops. Okay, so we're just going to go through these. So the need for action for this project had to do with doing some fuels reduction, looking at the mountain pine beetle mortality. I talked about travel management and then conifer encroachment. So pretty, like I said, pretty straightforward stuff that we do a lot. The scope of the project was one project area, a couple of watersheds. I'll keep going. Let's see, so the complexity was not outside of our normal type of work that we do. Like I said, the main complexity was the travel management, and there's all of these tiny little road segments that you identify in GIS, and you have to really figure out like every little segment, what should we do, and that makes it a little bit complicated, but not super outside the norm. Very similar to Elkhorn in terms of planning. Yeah.
What did you decide to do with the field treatment with the lack of snow?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a really good question. So I'm glad you asked that. So we have a fuels planner on our teams for these types of projects. And what she basically told us was there's work that we could do, like hand. Wait, let me go back to the map so I can kind of describe it. So here's County Road 59. We kind of said, like, east of here, we don't have very good snow. This is more, you know, low elevation as you drop down into 289. the tricky thing was that these roads go through these neighborhoods and they aren't really good enough or wide enough or straight enough for like large equipment to travel on. So we'd be hauling like a low boy with logging equipment that wasn't going to fly on these roads, and we can't really maintain. We weren't going to spruce up these roads on private land for this particular purpose. So
who's responsible for those roads when they kind of cross so many different parameters?
So that's really complicated. But I think the HOA maintains the road. There's kind of some issues right now about what kind of maintenance agreement they may or may not have. So they should, there should be a maintenance agreement in place when they're maintaining roads on the Forest Service. Yeah.
So what do you do then? Just like stop maintaining road crosses that private and split to where to use forest property and start up again, or?
So it depends on the situation. A lot of subdivisions just have maintenance agreements with us. So they say, we're going to maintain the road both on public and private land, and then here's the type of requirements. Like, we're not going to throw topsoil into the stream. Those are the kind of requirements we would tell them in this maintenance agreement. So that's the most typical situation. So related to the treatments, we really struggled to find ways to do fuel reduction treatment in that area east of 59. So we basically said if we came up with some like road corridors that we thought would be defensible for firefighters in concert with some of the open meadows that already exist there. We said we could do some mastication work. So we could get a masticator in there, but we couldn't get a log truck and a skidder and all of that. And we didn't want to pile. We didn't want to cut it and pile it and leave it there and not have any burn windows and just leave the fuels out there. But we did feel like this one unit here, unit 20, we could get up 59 and then it was just a short distance into the unit. We thought we could do some mechanical treatment in there. The really ironic thing is that, did you guys hear about the Starwood fire here over Labor Day weekend? We had a fire up there, I think it was like 300 and some acres. And it burned from like here to here. So now we're not so sure. We might do a little bit of treatment in this unit 20. Yeah, but most of it was treated. So now they have a really nice, so this neighborhood now has a little bit of more defensible space from, you know, prevailing winds from the west, and they've got a nice burn here. So that was kind of all interesting and ironic, but I'm glad you asked that question. So that's the way things go. Mother Nature took care of it. Okay, so complexity, ID team involvement. So that kind of goes back to the fuels planner saying, well, don't do business as usual here because we're really worried about leaving piles out there that we can't feasibly burn. The wildlife biologist and the hydrologist and the soil scientist were really pretty key in helping us figure out some of the travel management stuff, like, hey, this road actually goes down into the stream and then dips back up. Do we need that road? And if so, let's look at what other options there might be, or do we need to put some kind of culvert in or whatnot? So, and then those folks are, of course, pretty integral as the silviculturist designs the veg treatments, giving them feedback about, well, you know, we've got this goshawk nest there, we would need to put some kind of buffer around, we don't want you to treat right there. So that's some of the inner action that happens on the interdisciplinary team. Okay. I talked a little bit about public involvement already. Most of our comments were from folks that lived up there, and then the objections, same deal. And then line officer involvement on this one was, you know, it was one of our bigger planning projects on the district. So the district ranger at the time would come to the most of the team meetings and go in the field sometimes. So just keeping apprised of the progress. And then also when we got the objections, then the forest supervisor So one level up, got involved in the project. But pretty routine, nothing too out of the ordinary. But staying involved. And then I talked a little bit about partners and stakeholders. On this one, the stakeholders were largely the folks that lived up in that project area. And in terms of partners, I think it'll be more of a future type opportunities for some of our like forest restoration groups that are interested in what the kind of some lower elevation ponderosa pine restoration work up there. So that's the Cherokee Park project. And we can go back to any of these if you guys come up with questions.
So it seemed like this project in Elkhorn, mm-hmm. A lot of the commons, you know, we read through the Elkhorn view and a lot of it. We didn't really quite get to this in class because we had that guest speaker, but a lot of the commons were about the roads, if you recall. You know, I mean, it was just like, just probably 70% of all the commons were just about, you know, this road and closing this or this use and all that kind of thing. And I was, you know, I was really, that's a big deal for a landscape like this where there's probably a lot of intermingled private lands, you know, private properties and homes and stuff like up there. And so,
yeah.
You know, you might, you know, you typically think about, oh, you know, you're dealing with the fire and the forest, the vegetation stuff, but it's roads.
Which is a lot. Sometimes it's just totally administrative because some roads we have identified in GIS don't actually exist on the ground. Like nobody's used them for so long that they've grown over. And then there's a lot of user-created routes that we don't even, I mean, we know about a lot of them, but not all of them. So the road system on the ground doesn't, I mean, just even matching those together, it's kind of like just this huge ball of wax. Yeah.
Do you find, I don't know how much you interacted with the public, I imagine, a lot, but did you find that after someone objected and then, you know, you do your meeting or you talk to someone face-to-face or something like that, and explain what's going on, do some of those objections kind of get abated or disappear?
Yeah, sometimes they do. So there was a misunderstanding on the part of one of the objectors on this project about, it's been a little while, but I think it might have had to do with a road near his property or something. So we cleared that up with him and he withdrew his objection. The other objections we received were a couple of them were related to one of the subdivisions and their concerns about the public access possibly into their neighborhood. We had already met with them several times throughout the process to kind of explain where we were going with it and get their feedback and talk about what kind of authorization we'd like them to be under for the roads. And so at the end of the day, they still were very concerned about their position was they didn't want the public in their neighborhood.
Is it more like they're worried about hunters coming through or hikers, campers, that kind of thing?
Yeah, I think they're. I think the Cherokee Park area is pretty unique. It's different than Elkhorn. Elkhorn's a very higher recreation area. You know. We've got a lot of like off-road type folks that go up there or people that like to target shoot or just disperse camp or cut Christmas trees. So there is a lot of the public that goes up to Elkhorn. Cherokee Park, because of that land ownership pattern, it's not really a very public part of the forest. So I think their concern more had to do with making a new public part of the forest. So, okay. So just ask questions as they come up. Okay. So this was kind of, we talked about focus DAs a little bit, and we talked a little bit about disturbance. That meadow, what I didn't say about meadow and aspen enhancement, that's more of a response to not having enough disturbance in those areas to clean out, particularly in meadows, to keep those areas open. Now I'm going to talk about post-flood stream and floodplain restoration NEPA that I am working on. So that's going to be a categorical, we're going to use a categorical exclusion for this project. Were all of you around during the 2013 flood, like here in Colorado? But you might have heard about it. So The flooding in 2013 affected about 2,000 square miles, principally in Boulder and Larimer counties. And a lot of property damage was done. Maybe some people died as a result. A lot of people were displaced. There were lots of big messes. Many, many miles of roads were totally wiped out. So a lot of the flood response and flood restoration work from 2013 to now has taken place. So, you know, they're just now working on Highway 34, but a lot of the other roads have been reconstructed. A lot of folks have moved back into their homes or rebuilt their houses, that kind of thing. So the thing that's left now is to look at the impacts on floodplains and riparian areas as a result of not just the flooding, because that's a pretty natural process for floodplains and riparian areas, but the emergency stabilization work that was done as by like organizations like CDOT and FEMA had some pretty major impacts on streams and rivers in the flood impacted zone. So you'll see just in this little picture, you'll see some of this large equipment work being done. You'll see the stream on the left side of the photograph. Typically when we do any kind of like mechanical work around streams and rivers, we would have, you know, silt fencing, and we would exclude mechanical equipment from the stream corridors by a long ways. We would look at where we had areas of concern for like wildlife habitat, you know, we would kind of design it. In the case of an emergency like this flood, FEMA and CDOT were working to just make it okay for people to kind of, so they did a lot of work like that. They channelized many of the streams to get the flow under control. Let's see here. Here's just a couple of pictures to give you a sense. So here is Big Thompson Canyon. This is before, let's see here. This is showing you just kind of, no work was done in this part of the channel, but this is after the flood. So it looks pretty natural. There's some big boulders and whatnot. Here's a segment of the river that was channelized near Drake. So what they did was, you know, turn this into like a big irrigation ditch, basically got rid of all of the riparian vegetation, smoothed things out. There's no real floodplain that the river can rely on now. And then after the flood, no fish were actually found in this segment of river. So that's pretty serious. And here's another picture showing you the some more channelization work. And this one says trout biomass was reduced by 92% post-flood. Yeah.
Sorry, just to clarify, so after the flood, they reduced floodplains and took out all the vegetation.
So it was kind of when it was flooding, and right in the very aftermath, that they were trying to get the water off the road, trying to get it away from houses, trying to have more control over where the water was. Large chunks of roads were wiped out, and they were trying to just divert and direct the water into these channels.
That wasn't the Forest Service doing that work at the time?
No, the Forest Service didn't do that work. That was more, like I said, FEMA and CDOT, those kind of, the Army was here, that kind of thing. So these are kind of more extreme situations, but there was quite a bit of heavy equipment work in and around streams that had some very negative results for fisheries, for riparian vegetation, for wildlife that we rely on, that type of thing. And then also it kind of screwed up the floodplain in some cases. So now that they're rebuilding and reconstructing many of these roads, those Some of this is getting reworked and it's going to look great. There's some portions within the flood area, so in Boulder and Larimer counties, so two ranger districts where there's still some restoration work along the streams that we feel needs to be done. So for this planning project, we said, okay, here's the entire flood impacted area. It's not confined to a single ranger district. It's the Boulder Ranger District and the Canyon Lakes Ranger District. We're gonna do the same type of activities on both districts in the entire flood area. My particular feeling is we should combine similar things as often as possible because, like I said, it's expensive and it takes a lot of time to work through these projects. So, and like I said, we're gonna use a categorical exclusion. It just so worked out that they had added, the Forest Service had added three additional categories, like right before this happened, that allowed us to do projects related to disturbance. So we're getting to use this category 19, which you don't need to memorize. But I was going to talk. Have you guys talked much about CADEXs? Are you interested?
Yeah. Just what they are, but yeah.
Okay. So categorical exclusions are they don't preclude NEPA, but they simplify the NEPA process. So there are categories established either by the Secretary of Ag or by the Chief of the Forest Service that let us do types of routine work all the time. So Tony's probably already told you, anytime you spend federal money or have some kind of federal undertaking, we have to do NEPA. So that includes grading roads, fixing a toilet, let's see here, giving an environmental education program, those kind of things. So imagine if we had to do full-on NEPA documentation for those types of activities. So that's why these categorical exclusions exist, is for routine types of things that we do a lot. We feel that the impacts are null to minimal. And so this gives us a more rapid process to work through these types of projects. So there's some categorical exclusion or some categories that don't require any kind of paper trail, no project file. You don't have to have an actual decision. So that would be like repairing roads and trails and campgrounds. We don't need to do any kind of documentation. We have a category that says check. You can do that stuff without doing additional documentation and analysis. And then we have some categories that do require a decision memo and a project file where you really have to look at what are the impacts. So this is the type of project categorical exclusion where we do need to do a decision. We do need to have a project file. When you use a categorical exclusion, you need to consider extraordinary circumstances, or you need to still kind of run through a checklist and say, if I move this fire ring in my campground, am I gonna dig up a sacred burial site? Am I going to put it in, am I gonna put it right under a goshawk nest and then, make people congregate right there? So it doesn't preclude you from thinking about these things. What we often do for categorical exclusions is get a team together and say, here's what we're proposing to do. Does anybody have resource concerns? And the archaeologist will be like, well, let me check my maps. I have a pretty good sense of what's out there. Nope, I'm good. Nope, 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 we're good. Proceed. So, yeah.
Is there a single person in your office or department that kind of oversees all this and makes sure that all these things get CADEX'd or NEPA'd if they need to be?
So that's what I do.
Okay.
Yeah. It depends. So sometimes if the recreation department is building a new trail, they might be in charge of their NEPA.
Okay, so it's kind of
broken. It depends. So,
cool.
This is the type of thing that I work on. This is a project I'm working on right now, actually. What else did I want to say about categorical exclusions? So we use them actually quite a bit, but they're for very routine types of things like renewing a permit, that kind of thing. Okay, So the type of work, back to this flood restoration project, so the type of work that we're proposing using this CADEX is fish habitat structure repair and replacement. So that might be like log jams or things that provide good fish breeding, spawning habitat. Stream and floodplain restoration and reconstruction. So I kind of was showing you those floodplains that looked like little parking lots. So roughening those up, making those more like a, they should be. And then stream bank stabilization. So that could be putting in willow plantings or adding boulders and logs, that kind of thing. So not very controversial. Pretty, I think most folks feel like, yeah, of course you're gonna do this after an event like that. For the, I'll go through my little checklist.
Is that why it's CADEX? Because they just assume that you're gonna do this kind of work right after a flood or be fired?
Yeah, so, well, first you identify what's driving the need to do a project. So in this case, it was many floodplains and riparian areas were damaged as a result of the flood and the emergency stabilization activity. So that was the need for the project. So first you develop what that is, and then you develop, well, what do I want to do about it? So I told you there were three types of activities we wanted to do, the fish structures and the planting and whatnot. And then later you figure out, well, what's the appropriate level of analysis? Once, because you got to know what's the scope of my project, how many geographically and what kind of overlap would I have with threatened and endangered species. So you got to develop the project before you know whether you can use it. The reason we're using CADEX in this case is to help move the project along, and because we have one that specifically talks about this type of restoration activity, so it fits. You can't, even if it's a simple project, if you don't have a categorical exclusion for it, they have to be a match. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So I talked about the need for action. I talked about the scope. So the geographic scope was the flood impacted area, mainly along streams and rivers in that area. The complexity, the only thing that really makes this complex, adds to the complexity, is just that it's a relatively large area and there's maybe some differences in the type of work we're going to do one from one to the other, but pretty straightforward. The interdisciplinary team involvement on this one was the hydrologist, the fisheries biologist, and the we actually had a this great guy who specializes in riverine geomorphology and flooded areas. So those folks helped develop the proposal. Here's what we need to do in these areas. And then we kind of send that out to the wildlife biologist and the recreation specialist and the engineer and say, what do you think of our project proposal? And they give us some feedback. Since this is a programmatic type project, so it's covering a large area with a few different treatments, and we don't specifically say in Reach X we're going to do 5 willow plantings. We're not very specific in the document. So our wildlife biologist will do some programmatic consultation with Fish and Wildlife for that. Okay, so public involvement for this one, there's no, with categorical exclusions, there's no specified like flow chart, like here's exactly the number of days and how you need to put something in the newspaper. That doesn't exist for categorical exclusions. So we put a press release out and maybe had an article in the newspaper about this project. And we said, if you have questions or feedback, give us a call. So we didn't get anything from the public on this. In terms of line officer involvement, since we're including two districts on the forest supervisor will sign this. I think they might know about it, but basically I'll just go into his office when we're all kind of done and say, okay, so here's the deal with this one. Can you sign here? So not very controversial. Hopefully he says okay. Okay, and then in terms of partners and stakeholders, this one again is a little bit less so, well, the fisheries biologists and the hydrologists and the geomorphologists, they've been working with partners like the Poudre River Watershed Coalition and some of these different coalitions that were formed after the flood to help with the restoration work. So those folks, and along with groups like WRV, Wildland Restoration Volunteers, and some of our restoration type groups will be, and Trout Unlimited, those folks will be really key in getting these implemented on the ground. So not very controversial, not too complicated. We're gonna use a CE for this. And this is a response to an emergency. Right, some kind of or natural disaster, if you want to call it that. That Cherokee Park project was more of a, here's what we think is a good idea in this area, and we need to, you know, Congress is telling us we need to reduce hazardous fuels and look at our travel system. So that's what's kind of driving that project. So this one's a little different in that way. And then the next project related to shooting is yet even different in terms of what's kind of driving it. Okay, so question, oh yeah, go ahead.
If you would have done zero public involvement, is that okay? Like, is there zero public involvement required for most CADEXs, or?
So, we always publish our projects in the schedule of proposed action. So we're always informing the public, whoever's interested that wants to go to that site or get that by mail. They're always getting those.
But that's like a Forest Service sanctioned thing, right?
It or is it? Okay. Yeah. So with categorical exclusion, you're not required to have a public meeting or send out letters to a mailing list, which we did like for Cherokee Park. But you could. If you were going to do a project that you thought folks really, really cared about and they really wanted, I mean, you knew that they were going to give you input on that, then you should do that level of public involvement.
So if you decide that something's gonna be a CADEX, is there somebody who then you have to go through that kind of approves or disapproves that?
Yeah, so ultimately the forest supervisor will sign this and say, yeah, I think that's appropriate. I don't think a higher level of analysis like an EA or an EIS is necessary. And then similarly, when you sign an EA, the decision maker will say, I don't think an EIS is necessary. So anytime a decision's made, they're kind of checking that.
Right.
So, yeah.
What kind of monitoring is built into the categorical exclusion? Is it just kind of assumed that the biologist will continue to look after the trout after the project is completed, or is there something you actually say?
Yeah, so categorical exclusions are just a tool for streamlining the NEPA process. They don't have, and NEPA in general doesn't require anything very specific. However, let me give you an example. So that's a good question. So when our wildlife biologist consults with Fish and Wildlife on this programmatic flood restoration project, he's going to say, well, I don't know exactly where we're gonna do these treatments. We could use some mechanical equipment to place logs and boulders and install, you know, or to roughen up floodplains, that kind of thing. But I don't know exactly where that's gonna happen. So likely Fish and Wildlife and the Forest Service are gonna have an agreement that we will monitor those activities and then report how many acres of Preble's jumping mouse habitat are impacted by our activities. So that's kind of a by agreement type of, well, they tell us what we'll do. But we suggest and they say, yeah, that sounds good, or no, we don't like it. So it just depends on the project what level of monitoring we'll do. There's a time and there's a place where people promise to do a whole lot of monitoring. And what we find is that takes time and it costs a lot of money, so we need to be strategic about what's really necessary. So do we need to really go back and count how many conifers were removed in that meadow? Maybe, maybe not. So it depends on what you're looking for. But when you put it in a decision, you are saying, we're definitely going to do this. So just depends on the project.
Is FEMA paying for this, or is it coming out of Forest Service?
The NEPA?
No, the work.
The work. So for the flood restoration work, it'll probably be a lot of work with partners, like those watershed coalitions, the nonprofits, Trout Unlimited. It's more than likely that they will be applying for grants through different FEMA and other state of Colorado, all kinds of folks. And then we'll also use our money to do the work, too. And there are probably places that weren't destroyed by the heavy equipment that we might want to, like where fish structures were washed out, we might want to go back and put them in place. So it just kind of depends, but it'd probably be through that grant process with our partners.
So CDOT and FEMA just come in and they do their emergency work and then they're just like,
well, so think about a, I'm not trying to create a stir about that particular issue. So think about, it's kind of analogous to a wildfire. And so let's say the Forest Service is trying to protect homes and communities in the case of a wildfire. So we're probably gonna do slurry drops, build fire line maybe with bulldozers, cut down trees, do water drops, do all kinds of things with the idea that, with fire suppression in mind. If we designed that project, that's not how we would design it. But emergency response type actions are exempt from NEPA. And so in the case of a wildfire, we do suppression repair type work, so cleanup after.
Right. Yeah.
But when we're working on wildfires, folks have generally some guidelines about what's a good idea and what's not. In some cases they can implement it, in some cases they can't. It just depends on the emergency that they're working with. So it's not totally out of the ordinary for emergency response to create a whole nother set of problems because they're protecting some value of risk. I will say that our fisheries biologists and our hydrologists are not too thrilled about what occurred.
Well, wouldn't, as a Forest Service, if you did all those suppression activities, you would work with landowners in, like, mm-hmm. Slurry cleanup or cleaning up, you have to clean that up, or, whatever.
Yeah. So we have, like, best management practices for slurry. So, for example, we don't drop within a certain buffer distance of streams. It happens occasionally, but...
So maybe it would be more of like an educational aid instead of a financial aid to landowners?
For wildfire suppression repair?
Do you help fund that repair in terms of like if it's on private property?
For the High Park fire, there was a lot of work done on private and public property in terms of fire lines and things like that. So some suppression repair was done on public and private, paid for, I'm sure, by the fire account, which, it all comes out of the big fund in the sky. And then there was a lot of bare, burned area, restoration activity that was done. So that was like seeding and mulching. And so the NRCS does a lot of the work with private landowners, and we do more of the stuff on forest land or public land. So that's kind of NRCS's deal, is working with private landowners. Okay, cool, we'll keep rolling.
Almost there.
Okay. Cool. Okay, so now I want to talk about the most interesting project in the world. So this is the sport shooting project that I'm working on right now. So I'm going to first just give you a little bit of background to help you understand the need for action, right? So that's one of our check marks. So So currently the Arapahoe Roosevelt Pawnee is considered an urban forest. You know, we're very close to the Denver metropolitan area, the whole Front Range population that's large and growing at a pretty alarming, well, a rapid rate. Something like 100,000 folks a year are moving to Colorado, mostly to the Front Range. So it's like a small city each year. This is just the lights at night. So the forest is right in here. So I-70 and I-25 are right here. I talked to you a little bit about intermingled land ownership pattern, but here's a little snip from the Boulder Ranger District where we have like the equivalent of pickup sticks in terms of, like, somebody just threw pickup sticks on the map and said, that looks good. So these are all mining claims, these little strips. And then this lighter area is forest. So then we have, so we manage this little sliver, this little sliver, this little sliver, this little sliver, this one, this one. And then there's like, we might authorize road access through here. It creates just a amazing workload for our lands and special uses folks. Just the land ownership pattern, and because folks live on these parcels. So I think we estimate between 35 and 40,000 homes inside of our forest boundary, people living on these little chunks. Target shooting is a pretty popular activity on the National Forest. It has been for quite some time, people going out to sight their hunting rifle. What we're finding is that the sport is kind of changing in character, so more folks are coming out with their AK-47s or pistols to target shoot on the forest. And there's more folks living near the forest, so more people are recreating, more people are shooting in general. Right now you can go out and target shoot on most places on the National Forest, as long as you're shooting safely, using good judgment, and we have some rules about you need to be 150 yards away from campgrounds and trailheads. Can't shoot in an occupied area, that kind of thing. So that seems like it would work, but what we're finding is that there's so many people using the forest and so many people living here that we're having some pretty intense conflicts about this particular use. And firing weapons makes a lot of noise, so it makes people nervous. And there's that whole thing of if you get hit by a bullet, it can be kind of bad. So this one's kind of a big deal. So currently our 1997 forest plan doesn't have any guidance about what to do about sport shooting. 20 years ago, maybe it wasn't such a big use and we didn't have quite as many people using the forest, so we just left it out altogether. Well, we didn't think about it because it wasn't a problem. We have some issues with concentrated shooting. So what we find on this forest, and again, we're in an urban forest with a lot of people, folks drive up a road, back their car up, unload their weapons and their targets and the stuff they want to shoot at, and shoot into a hillside. That's okay if they're using a legitimate target and they're using good judgment. What's tricky though is when people congregate and concentrate, we are amplifying the resource impacts related to lead and impacts on water quality. Also, if you shoot a lot of bullets, you will denude an area. So that's okay if it's like one person occasionally. This is one area it's now closed because the flood totally wiped it out. This was Left Hand Canyon in Boulder, and you can see that this is totally denuded, this hillside. This is trash that's been packed out. Some folks shoot totally legitimate targets, like paper targets and whatever, but some people like to haul like refrigerators and computer monitors and beer bottles out and shoot at them and then leave that stuff. So we also have some areas where there's just a lot of debris left over. And like I mentioned, and then we have all those folks living near, living in and near the forest.
So this is Boulder County, and the forest boundary is about here, going west. All these little black dots are homes, and then these brown is just like maybe a half mile buffer around the house. So these little cell phones, I love this symbol, are complaint calls that the Boulder, complaint or safety calls that the Boulder County Sheriff received between January of 2013 and August of 2015, 986 calls that the sheriff received. The sheriff's department tells us this is a big deal because if there's calls related to firearms and safety, we have to respond. So we have to drive up there and check out what's going on. That's a huge drain on their resources. Potentially they're helping protect folks living up there, but a lot of times they drive up there and don't find anybody. Or I hear bullets near my house. I can't tell you exactly where it is. Or I hear, you know, shots fired near my house, but I can't tell you exactly where it is, you know, but here's within a 5 mile range. So it's really tricky. Sometimes we hear from people that a bullet just hit my siding and I don't feel safe at my house. We also hear, I'm tired of hearing noise 24/7 on the weekends from people firing their weapons. So some of these calls are safety, some are noise. But this just gives you an idea of one of the challenges. So currently on our forest, about 1% of the forest is under like an emergency closure. So there's these different little blobs on our map that say you can't shoot here because we've had safety issues at this particular area. So this is just a little map showing you one of our closures. I think this is the Buckhorn Road or St. Gulch, maybe, in Larimer County. So right now you can shoot on the forest pretty much anywhere. Only about 1% is closed. I mean, what we find though is that people aren't generally shooting in remote areas like wilderness and roadless areas because the equipment's heavy, and maybe there's some other reasons too. But what we do find is a lot of folks tend to congregate in these sites. I don't want to get you too fired up, but so these are. These are a couple of sites that I'll show you. This is a site on the Boulder Ranger District where people have actually shot down trees because there's so much bullet action. It takes like an incredible number of bullets to actually shoot down a tree. And then you'll see this is an ephemeral drainage with some shooting debris, presumably some lead. So this has us concerned. But, you know, mainly we're concerned that there's a lot of folks using the forest, there's a lot of people shooting, not everybody's using good judgment. We're really, really concerned that someone will be hurt or killed as a result of this interaction.
Have that happened yet?
Okay, so we have not had a fatality on our forest related to target shooting, but the Pike National Forest did have one last summer. So we've been working on this for a long time. It wasn't as a result of what happened on the Pike. We've been kind of thinking that this is an issue that needs some attention for a while. What else was I gonna say? Well, it'll come to me. So since 2013, the forest has been in this partnership called the Northern Front Range Recreational Sports Shooting Management Partnership. I just call it partnership. To come up with more of a landscape level approach to a multi-jurisdictional approach to managing sports shooting so that it's safe and responsible along the Northern Front Range. So what we're finding is that by closing, okay, we have a safety issue here, we got to close this area, this 50-acre area. What we're finding is people drive up the road a little bit further and then created the next safety issue. So we wanted to stop taking a band-aid approach and look at it more from a landscape level. So we have in this partnership, it's four counties, Gilpin, Clear Creek, Boulder, and Larimer County, and then Colorado Parks and Wildlife. So we meet with them pretty regular, like monthly, And there's three prongs of this partnership. We have an MOU in place. What else can I tell you? They are cooperating agencies. So they've actually signed on as cooperating agencies for this project. Let's see here. So the three prongs of the strategy, and I'm not going to get into this too much because it's a little bit out away from NEPA, but it helps you understand kind of the complexity of this project. So the partnership basically said we want to educate users and non-users about safe and responsible shooting. We want to find places where we can develop shooting ranges. We'd love to send a lot of folks to shooting ranges because we would have lead mitigation in place. We'd have safety features, lanes and berms and backstops and bathrooms. We really want a lot of people to shoot in ranges. And then the Forest Service will look at some kind of management strategy for sport shooting in addition to amending our forest plan that provides some amount of like overarching guidance for sport shooting on the forest. When we come up with when we finally revise our forest plan, we may include something from the get-go about sport shooting now that we know it's kind of an issue on the forest. But forest plan amendments are a stopgap because forest plans cost a lot of money and they take a lot of time, and only a few in the region get done at once. Okay, so we're doing things like releasing YouTube videos about and having a web presence about safe and responsible shooting, or working with the counties to develop shooting ranges. And then the forest has come out with, we came out with a proposal last summer to look at where on the forest is suitable and where is not suitable for dispersed shooting. And I won't go into the map too much, but I'll tell you just in general, we said this blue, anything in blue would be closed to dispersed shooting. So this had a lot to do with, we have thousands of homes here. We have lots and lots of trailheads. It's just a really busy place. It's not a really good place to shoot, particularly if you have bad judgment. So, whereas,
just a bad shot.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. If you are shooting, I always use this analogy, but if you're shooting in nowhere Montana and you're using poor judgment, the consequences are, okay, so I don't have my target. But if I'm shooting here and I use poor judgment and I don't hit my target, the risks are just so much higher. So this is programmatic, right? Because we're looking forest-wide, and it's not like site-specific, looking in the brush to find out if there's mites there and that kind of thing. Yeah.
How does this work during the hunting season? How do you?
So this doesn't. We don't. We don't manage hunting. The state does, so it doesn't relate to hunting at all.
How do you differentiate someone that's hunting versus someone that's shooting?
Yeah, so 100% of the time you couldn't, but somebody should have a permit for hunting. And if they're firing off like 1,000 rounds at a target with an AK-47, I'm pretty sure they're not hunting, right? So, and usually hunters are firing not very many rounds, trying not to scare away whatever they're hunting.
They're not hunting there.
Yeah, no. I mean, they have hunting units, though.
Hunting units.
Yeah.
And it's the private landowners intermix that, you know, they get, they'll draw or they'll go over the counter. They'll have, and they'll literally just, you know, get whatever comes across their back.
I'm sorry, I gotta send a text to the social scientist that's helping me on this project. She's coming up from Denver today.
Is that Julie?
Julie.
Oh, tell her you're in my class. I'm going to go to Jay's class. I'll be late. Can you talk a little bit about what a programmatic NEPA is versus a,
okay,
just kind
so
of get,
yep.
get a little bit more to differentiate
sure.
between project level versus programmatic. Is that those are that's a
yeah. Okay, so the Cherokee Park project that I talked about first, that's a project level NEPA. So we're using our forest plan guidance to tell us these are the type of activities that are appropriate in these areas, and these are the ones that aren't. We're also very specific about where we will do what. So we've outlined on the map exactly where we would do thinning or clear cutting or piling or using mechanical equipment. These are the exact roads that we would want to decommission. So that's project level, site specific NEPA. The flood, CADEX, and this proposal are programmatic because they're not very specific about an individual place on the ground. And this one, I guess you would also, because we're amending the forest plan, that also gets more into kind of a higher level of guidance. What else do you
so
want to say about that? Yeah.
So does programmatic NEPA, is that at the forest level? I mean, is it the same kind of team? Is it the same kind of analysis?
Yeah.
Or?
Right. Yeah. So it can be. Sometimes the Washington office will do programmatic NEPA. There was a programmatic EIS done for slurry on wildfires at the Washington office level. So it kind of prescribes some best management practices related to slurry. It can be just a regular ID team on the forest. Like in this case, I have a team that's working on this. So their analysis is going to, we're talking about this afternoon again, but their analysis is gonna be a lot different than the type of analysis they do for Cherokee Park. One, because the Cherokee Park type of treatments are very routine, and we know what thinning looks like in ponderosa pine, and we have a pretty good idea about the impacts. For the analysis here, we're probably gonna talk about risk more than we are about very specific effects. So we're gonna say, related to the no action alternative or the existing condition, the risk to watersheds is greater under a no action scenario because of these reasons. The impacts to folks that like to sport shoot on the national forest would be negative and greater under the proposed action than the existing condition when they can shoot those places. So this is a little bit different type of analysis. It's this project is so much more politically and socially driven, and that's why I have our regional social scientist sitting on the team. So she's gonna help talk about human behavior and what conflict looks like, and are there issues related to socioeconomic issues related to taking away free target shooting experiences for people. What about home values where we have shooting nearby? So it's a really different type of project because the wildlife analysis is not like so many other types of projects. So, yeah.
So will this be an EIS? It's so complex.
It will be an EA.
It'll be an EA.
So we could do an EIS for this project. We don't, so the trigger there is whether you have significant effects or not. So we're saying, right now we're saying it's an EA. Yeah.
When you choose to do an EA, are you just expecting that the finding of those?
Yes, right. So we could do an environmental analysis, and then when we go to do our FONSI, we could say, oh, whoops, I guess we do have a significant impact. We need to do an EIS. We also didn't get any comments from folks about whether you really need to do an EIS for this project. So that's what we're planning on for the time. Let me talk about public involvement a little bit. What time is it? 26. Okay, so for this project, we had a lot of very interested people from all types of groups. So we had folks that live in or near the forest that are very interested in this project. We have folks that really, really like to shoot on the forest that are interested in this. We have the NRA and some different sportsmen's foundations that are very interested. We have the county sheriffs. We have the county commissioners. We have the state that's interested. So. And other people too. We have the senators and the representatives that are interested in this project. So for this one, we kind of like pulled out all the stops in terms of public involvement. So we did a very long public involvement process to give us time to do 4 public meetings. So we did public meetings in 4 different places. We got about, say, 1,600 or 1,700 comments in total. I told you Cherokee Park was maybe around 20. So we got 1,600 or 1,700 comments. We get phone calls and emails about it all the time. So what else about public involvement? Oh, and then as a result, there was a lot of media coverage, which doesn't always happen for your project. So can you give a radio interview? Can you give a TV interview? The New York Times didn't have an article specifically about our forest, but they had one about target shooting at about the same time. So this one's kind of a big one. Our forest supervisor has been to DC a couple of times to brief senators and the Washington office on this project and then a couple of others. So this one's kind of a big deal.
So I guess for all students and people that are getting in natural resources and some of our programs and they wanna go out and manage the resource, you find, you went and got a graduate degree in ecology and, learned about ecosystems and all that stuff. You end up working on issues that involve a lot of more social political complexity than you signed up for. So how do you find the
joy?
Interest. Yeah, how do you make it interesting, right? Because you have to, or else you leave.
Yeah, yeah.
You say,
yeah.
I don't want to do this, I want to do something else.
Right.
If you're going to deal with natural resources and environmental management, this is part of the deal, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so NEPA is not for everybody. Before I worked in this position, I thought it would be like super boring. I think it just depends on your personality and your interest. So my personal feeling is that you have to like working with people, and you have to have kind of a multidisciplinary mindset, right? And it's really good if you're organized and can keep the process moving along and you sort of geek out on that stuff. So, you work on a variety of stuff, Tony. So last year we did a project related to greenback, cutthroat, trout restoration up in George Creek, so north part of the county. So that's pretty ecology-ish, you know. The Cherokee Park project is, and even the flood project, that's more kind of ecology. The sports shooting project, I have to say, it's probably the most interesting project I've worked on, and it's also kicking my butt, but it is so much more social. But I think I've been talking to my ID team about this in terms of there are some impacts on our resources on the forest as related to this activity, and then how do we help inform this process? What especially related to like water quality, that's a big one. So even though it's more of a social project, there's still that ecology stuff that matters. So, it just totally depends on what you're into. If you're really into, let me think of an example. If you're really into range management and botany and like habitat restoration, this particular project might not seem that interesting to you, but they actually are really all interrelated. And that's what you learn in ecology, right? Is everything's related. Yeah. So I'm not gonna spend too much time because I told Tony I have to leave a minute ago. But for this project, this is still in the works, but we are thinking about once we sign a decision on this, how do we kind of adapt to changing conditions? So if our proposed action calls for closing about 20% of the forest to shooting, but what if we have some issues we don't expect somewhere else? And what might those be? So this adaptive management piece in the sport shooting project is gonna be pretty important, and there's not a good template for how you write this. So we're kind of trying to figure that out.
So what if we get a big new neighborhood in an area that stays open? Would that prompt us to look at our closures? What if we have new safety issues in different places? What if we have some impacts in wilderness that are not acceptable? What if we build a new campground in an open area, that kind of thing? Or what if we reach some level of resource degradation that we say this is not acceptable? So we're still figuring this out, but we're just looking at, we know we're not going to be perfect. So how do we develop a framework to manage this adaptively without doing a new, long, expensive, time-consuming NEPA project? So we would like some flexibility in the end here. So I talked about adaptive management. I'm not going to talk about climate change, sorry. That's for somebody else. Okay, so I'll just run through these pretty quick. I talked about the need for action. I talked about the scope being forest-wide. The scope is forest-wide. It's also really interesting because I'm getting calls from other forests saying, so what are you guys doing? We're kind of interested to see how that goes for you. So this, it's not always good to be the first one out of the gate, but we want to address this issue, and we'll see how well we do as to whether other forests follow suit or not.
You said you work on Pawnee too, right? Isn't that kind of the big issue out there?
Yeah, so this particular project does not include the Pawnee grassland.
Right,
we feel like the some of the issues and the topography and the oil and gas development make it just a different type of project
mm-hmm.
out there. But it has been. We also have a shooting range
right.
out there that we manage. So. Okay, so pretty complex, I think, at least for my little brain. ID team involvement has been very different than for a lot of other projects, right? So the ID team in this case is not really driving. We will probably have some alternatives to our proposed action. So the ID team isn't driving this alternatives and saying you need to have an alternative that doesn't cut old growth habitat. That might be in some kind of a timber project. So the alternatives are more driven by social and political factors. But there, we still have a team that will do the analysis. I talked about public involvement being pretty heavy. The line officer involvement is a lot for this one. So I meet with the forest supervisor pretty regularly, also keeping the district rangers apprised because this is an issue for them. And you know, it's kind of feeding up. So, and then like I said, our forest supervisor is talking with his superiors in the Washington office or the regional office about this issue. Okay, and I talked about partners and stakeholders already. Okay, so this is my second to last slide. So in terms of like what NEPA looks like and what my day-to-day life looks like, I kind of came up with this conclusion, it just totally depends. Right, so it depends on the complexity of the project, the external factors, internal factors, political factors, and all of that. So hopefully I gave you kind of a snapshot of, you kind of get the basics of what NEPA is about, but it really just depends on what you're proposing to do on the ground and what's driving that need. So, okay, so before I end, most of you kind of already had some experience working for the federal government, but I just wanted to turn you on to, if you go to opm.gov and click on career development, I think you'll get to, eventually you can look at this pathways program for students and recent grads, and it'll talk about what that is, find internships or find recent grad jobs. I think that's a really, really good way for all of you to get your foot in the door, like way better than being a seasonal for 15 years. When you work with the government, a lot of times the expectation is you'll move to where the job is. So this would be nationwide. And I think there's a real big push right now to bring folks in at that level. So I just wanted to put a plug into learning about pathways. seeing what opportunities are out there. There are also, if you get kind of plugged in, you might hear about hiring events or like job fairs where people can do direct hire at those type of events. So I'm not an expert on this, but I thought since I was talking to aspiring federal employees that I would at least tell you about this.
Chad, did you get Pathways?
Yeah, I got it. But that's how I ended up in Nevada.
Mm-hmm.
And you did one of those speed interviews at SAF, right?
Yeah.
And they run on spot.
Yep, the next day.
That's a good way to go.
Awesome. So, Nahal, thank you. Let's give Nahal a thank you.